putting aside the labels, we can't afford to let any brain power in society off the hook from being part of that problem. So it's, Tommy's absolutely right. And advocacy is, in the end, advocacy is at the heart of all of this. But I think we have to graduate to a whole other kind of advocacy that we haven't been doing enough of. And I say we, that includes myself as well.
Yeah. You know, we always have people who own some stocks in some of these corporations, and they go into the stockholders' meetings, and they talk, and they have a little bit of talking into the wind. And that's an attempt to talk to corporate power. It hasn't been that successful.
But a lot of that has not been talked. Has not been the effort to talk their language. And you know, when you go in to see a legislator, one of the things you try to do is you try to talk the legislator's language. And I think that that's the, you know, it's kind of a fine point, I know. But if we're going to lobby corporations, I think we have to learn to talk their language. We have to learn to talk about the marketplace as well as easily as we learn to talk about political precincts. You know, we have to be able to talk about the marketplace. And it's a real challenge. It's not easy to do.
Well, how about talking to our legislators about creating a price for not doing it, just as we're trying now with the carbon tax rather than carbon trade, to put a price on carbon emissions, which cause the corporations are not acting on a part. Right? They're acting on a profit,
right.
So what they see is their advantage.
Yeah, I have some problems with that, and when it comes to water in particular, because I would hate to create a system where you can pay to make children die, you know? If you pay for pollution, it's easy to integrate that into the cost of the product. And nobody should have to buy their way out. I think that's true on the climate side too. Look at the Clean Water Act as an example. The Clean Water Act said elimination of discharge of pollutants by 1985, fishable and swimming waters by 1983, elimination of the discharge of toxic pollutants and toxic amounts. Imagine if we had a climate treaty that specific. There would be a parade in the streets. The problem with the parade in the streets is that the law that was that specific failed miserably. And even if, you know, even with huge punishments for violating the law, it's failed miserably. If we made them pay for their pollution, it would continue to fail, and climate's going to continue to fail until the innovations take place. And I'm very concerned that we're not going down both roads at the same time. That we're not having the kind of conversations with corporate America that are going to make innovation. Continuing down this road of them being a permanent enemy, when also they're the employers of society, and we almost have to do all of it.
It's a very delicate balance.
It is a delicate balance, but we've got to get the best out. Yeah.
And the one, you know, in concert with what Connie is saying, you know, I'm working in business world. We as citizens and advocates have no leverage in terms of creating the equation that says we're going to punish you if you're a bad corporate citizen and pollute the way you're polluting, and it's going to cost you money to renovate and innovate to be a better person.
Yeah.
We don't have the leverage except through our elected officials and our legislatures to try and create government-sponsored incentives. If you stop this and start this, there has to be some benefit. Corporations will not invest in improvement without a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I'm not sure how we don't demonize those people who are bad corporate citizens.
Well, I'm with you. I just can tell you from my own experience, there are few people who have spent as much time fighting against corporations as I have, and making demons out of them have not gotten us anywhere near as far as we thought it was going to.
still,